Welcome once again to Bosco Campus Vision. You are viewing the campus television channel of Kottayam Don Bosco College, and you are listening to a lecture on informatics and cyber law. And this is our second lecture on the cyber law. In our first lecture on the cyber law, we defined what is cyber law, and we said that the source of cyber law in India is the Information Technology Act of 2000. This IT Act 2000 was the first legislation in India on technology, on computers, on electronic commerce, electronic communication. So this was the first source of cyber law in India. IT Act 2000 was subject to much debates, criticism, review. After much debates, criticism, review, the Information Technology Amendment Act was published in December 2008. Now, IT Amendment Act 2008, it contains 14 chapters and 124 sections. We said IT Act 2000 consisted of 13 chapters and 94 sections, and IT Amendment Act of 2008 consists of 14 chapters and 124 sections. IT Amendment Act of 2008 has substantial additions to the IT Act of 2000. We know that the original Act, IT Act 2000, was developed to promote the information technology industry, to regulate the electronic commerce, or to facilitate electronic governance, and to prevent cyber crimes. We have learned about the objectives of IT Act 2000. The first objective was to legalize all electronic records that is used in all kinds of electronic transactions, electronic commerce. The second objective was to legalize digital signatures. Digital signatures are used for authenticating all kinds of electronic records that are used in electronic transactions. The third objective defined different kinds of cyber crimes and the penalty for these cyber crimes. Those were the objectives of IT Act 2000. The IT Amendment Act of 2008, it also sought to foster security practices in all kinds of electronic transactions and electronic commerce. So one additional objective that IT Amendment Act 2008 brought forth is fostering of security practices in all kinds of electronic transactions. While IT Act 2000 talked about digital signatures as a mechanism for authorizing, authenticating all electronic documents, the IT Amendment Act of 2008 will talk about electronic signatures. There is a change in the term. It is not digital signatures, electronic signatures. Now, this term electronic signatures will include digital signatures as well as other modes of authentication. There are other modes of electronic authentication which is achieved through biometrics. We know what is biometrics. Biometrics is using the biological features of persons for authentication. It may be our fingerprints, it may be our retina scan, it may be our facial scan. So the term electronic signature is adopted as legally valid mode of executing signatures. They will include digital signatures and other modes of authentication like biometrics. The Section 43A of IT Amendment Act 2008, it talks about the corporate responsibility for data protection. Corporate responsibility. The organizations, the corporate organizations who have access to the personal information of customers or online shoppers, they are responsible. What is the responsibility? They should adopt reasonable security practices which will maintain the secrecy of the information, the secrecy of the personal information of the individuals. And if they are unable to protect the secrecy, if they are unable to protect the personal information of individuals, they may be liable to pay damages. And it is said that there is no limit to the amount of compensation that may be awarded by virtue of their section. So this Section 43A of IT Amendment Act talks about the responsibility of the organizations in the protection of the personal data of individuals. they have to adopt features by which there is reasonable security that is provided for the personal information of all individuals. Otherwise, the penalty can be very heavy. There are two important definitions that are added to IT Amendment Act of 2008. One is in Section 2HA and the second one is in Section 2W. Now, the Section 2HA, it is talking about communication device. So, by integrating, by adding this particular phrase communication device in Section 2HA, all communication devices, not only computers and laptops, other communication devices like the cell phones, iPods, and all the other devices that are used for communication to send data, to receive data. The data may be text, audio, or video, or photo. So, all the devices that are used to send data and receive data are brought under this term called communication device. Similarly, in Section 2W, another term is added. The term is intermediary. And this term will clarify all the service providers that will come in internet. The customers and the internet, there are in between, there are intermediaries who provide services. So, by integrating, including this particular term intermediary, it is integrating all telecom service providers, all network service providers, all internet service providers, all web hosting service providers, all search engines, online payment sites, online auction sites, online marketplace, and all cyber cafes. So, by integrating the term intermediary in Section 2W, it has brought all these intermediary service providers under this Act, IT Amendment Act 2008. There are many cyber crimes that are defined in Section 66, and we have discussed all of them in our previous lecture. 66A would talk about offensive or false messages and the penalty for the same. 66B will talk about receiving stolen computer resources. 66C will talk about identity theft. 66D will talk about cheating by impersonation. 66E will talk about violation of privacy. And 66F will talk about cyber terrorism. Now, all these things we have defined and discussed. And the penalty for all this we have discussed in our previous lecture. For the details, please refer to the first lecture on the cyber law. In the case of some offenses, some changes have been brought forth in IT Amendment Act of 2008. For example, hacking, which was defined in Section 66. The punishment for hacking has been enhanced from 3 years of imprisonment and a fine of 2 lakhs to a fine of 5 lakhs. So, there is a change in the fine that is enhanced in IT Amendment Act 2008. The fine is enhanced from 2 lakhs to 5 lakhs. Section 67 of IT Act 2000 contained the offense called publishing of obscene information. The punishment for publishing obscene information for the first instance was an imprisonment for 5 years and a fine of 1 lakhs. Now, this has been changed. The imprisonment for 5 years has been reduced from 5 years to 3 years, and the fine has been increased from 1 lakh to 5 lakhs. Similarly, the penalty for publishing obscene information in the second instance, in the subsequent instance, was an imprisonment for 10 years and a fine of 2 lakhs. Now, this has been changed. The punishment for publishing obscene information in the subsequent instance has been reduced from 10 years imprisonment to 5 years imprisonment, and the fine has been increased from 2 lakhs to 10 lakhs. So, there is a change in punishment for the offense of publishing obscene information in the internet. IT Amendment Act of 2008 adds an additional section, Section 67A. This section adds an offense of publishing material containing sexually explicit conduct. Now, materials containing this sexually explicit conduct is punishable with an imprisonment for a term that may extend up to 5 years and a fine up to 10 lakhs of rupees. This provision is added in 67A to prevent all kinds of MMS attacks and all kinds of video voyeurism. Therefore, a new section is added in IT Amendment Act of 2008. It contains section 67A that adds an offence of publishing material containing sexually explicit conduct, and it is punishable. Section 67B of IT Amendment Act of 2008 talks about child pornographic material. The publishing of child pornographic material in the internet is punishable with an imprisonment for 5 years and a fine up to 10 lakhs of rupees. Even browsing of child pornographic material, browsing of child pornographic websites are punishable under Section 67B of Information Technology Amendment Act of 2008. Another addition that is done in IT Amendment Act of 2008 is Section 69B. What is Section 69B? It confers on the central government the power to appoint any agency to monitor and collect the traffic data or information generated or transmitted or received or stored in any computer resource in order to enhance its cyber security. So, the central government can appoint any agency that can track the information that are sent or received or stored in a computer resource for the sake of cyber security. So, it can identify, it can analyze, it can prevent the intrusion or spread of any common viruses or any malicious software that can disturb the security of the country. So, the central government can appoint any agency that can track any information that is sent in the internet, in the space. It is for the security of the nation. It is for cyber security. So far we have discussed what is a cyber law, the source of cyber law in India, IT Act 2000 and the IT Amendment Act of 2008. We have considered the different provisions, the offences, the penalties for these offences that are mentioned in IT Act 2000 and IT Amendment Act of 2008. Now we will go on to discuss some cyber related provisions that are given in the Indian Penal Code. The Indian Penal Code of 1860, that is the main criminal code of India. It covers all the aspects of the criminal law. We said one of the objectives of IT Act 2000 was to amend the Indian Penal Code so as to integrate the cyber related provisions to the Penal Code. Therefore, IT Act 2000 has amended the sections dealing with records and documents in the IPC. It has integrated the word electronic before records and documents in the IPC. By this, all the electronic records are treated equal with all the physical records and documents. Thus, one of the amendments that IT Act 2000 has made is to integrate or insert the word electronic before the records and documents of IPC. Now, we will go on to discuss some of the important cyber related provisions that are considered under the Indian Penal Code. Section 503 of Indian Penal Code talks about sending threatening messages by email. A person can threaten another person through email. The threat may be that he will injure that person, or the threat may be that he will injure his property or his good name. The threat may be that he will injure his relatives or families. Now, these threats can cause alarm to the person, or this threat can cause that person to do some acts which he is not legally bound to do, or these threats can cause that person to omit to do any act which that person is legally entitled to do. These are known as criminal intimidation. So, a person can cause criminal intimidation to another person using an email. This offense is considered under Section 503 of IPC. A person threatening another person using email is considered as an criminal intimidation. The punishment for criminal intimidation is mentioned in Section 506 of the IPC. What is the punishment? Whoever commits the offense of criminal intimidation shall be punished with imprisonment for a term which may extend up to 2 years, or with fine, or with both the imprisonment as well as the fine. So, the Section 503 of IPC talks about criminal intimidation using an email. or sending threatening messages using an email. The punishment for criminal intimidation using email is mentioned in section 506 of IPC. Section 507 of IPC talks about criminal intimidation by an anonymous communication. We know what is anonymous communication. Anonymous communication is a communication hiding the identity of the person, hiding the source from the communication comes. What is the punishment for criminal intimidation by anonymous communication? The person shall be punished with imprisonment for a term which may extend up to 2 years. In addition to the punishment that is given under section 506. Section 499 of IPC talks about sending defamatory messages by an email. What is defamatory messages? These are messages that can cause harm to the good name of the person, to the reputation of the person. So when a person through words or signs publishes through email any allegation, any accusation concerning another person, that can spoil the good name of that person, that can spoil the reputation of person, that is known as sending defamatory messages by an email. So what is the punishment for sending defamatory messages by an email? The punishment is mentioned in section 500 of IPC. Whoever defames another person shall be punished with simple imprisonment for a term which may extend up to 2 years, or with fine, or with both. Section 463 of IPC talks about forgery of electronic documents. And what is forgery? Forgery is making false documents. When a person makes any false documents or part of any document or an electronic record with the intention to cause damage to the public or to the person, or to claim a property, or for any fraudulent behavior, he is said to commit forgery. So forgery can be committed by creating false electronic documents. Now, what is the punishment for forgery of electronic documents? The punishment is mentioned in 469, section 469 of IPC. Whoever commits forgery shall be punished with imprisonment for a term which may extend up to 3 years, and shall also be liable to a heavy fine. The section 420 of IPC talks about bogus websites and cyber frauds. Bogus websites would mean fake websites. So creating fake websites with the intention to defraud others, to cheat others, will come under the section 420 of IPC. Similarly, any kind of fraudulent behavior using computers or internet will come under the cyber fraud under the section 420 of IPC. And any fraudulent behavior that is done using the computers or the internet is punishable. Section 509 of IPC talks about online defamation of women. Whoever intends to insult the modesty of a woman, either using a word or making any sound or gesture or exhibiting some objects online, intending that such words or gestures or objects be seen by that woman, or any person who is intruding into the privacy of a woman, he is said to have committed the online defamation. So any action that will insult the modesty of a woman is online defamation. Now, what is the punishment for online defamation? The person shall be punished with simple imprisonment for a term which may extend up to 1 year, or with fine, or with both the imprisonment and the fine. The section 378 of the IPC talks about theft of computer hardware. We know what is a theft. Theft is taking away any computer hardware of a person without his permission. Dishonestly taking away any property of a person without the consent of the person is known as theft. Now, what is the punishment for theft of computer hardware? The punishment for the theft of computer hardware is mentioned in section 379 of IPC. It says that whoever commits theft shall be punished with imprisonment for a term which may extend up to 3 years, or with fine, or with both imprisonment as well as fine. So section 378 and 379 of IPC talks about the theft of computer hardware and the corresponding punishment for the theft of hardware. Thus, in our two lectures, we have talked about what is cyber law, the scope of cyber law. The source of cyber law in India is the IT Act of 2000 and the IT Amendment Act of 2008. We have considered all the provisions of the IT Act 2000 as well as the IT Amendment Act of 2008. All the offenses and the corresponding penalties of all these cyber crimes we have discussed. We also have discussed the important cyber related provisions under Indian Penal Code. All these provisions will help to secure all our electronic transactions. It will help us to secure all our online businesses. It also will help to secure all information that is in our computer. We have considered all the legal framework that will help to secure all our electronic transactions. I suppose this video was useful to you. It will help you to prepare for examinations. It also will help you to behave ethically in the cyberspace. It also will help you to secure all your transactions in the internet, in the cyberspace. Thank you for your patient listening.